Dear students, having seen the consequences of heteroscedasticity in the last class, we now consider how to detect heteroscedasticity. Since heteroscedasticity is a problem, we have to detect it. Then only we can devise methods to correct it. Now, like multicollinearity, there are only rules of thumb procedures to detect heteroscedasticity. The reason is that if you want to know heteroscedasticity pattern, the entire population must be known, because sigma square I is related to the population. But in the real world, we have only one y corresponding to one x. So, detection of heteroscedasticity is actually a question of guess, not a simple guess, educational guess. Speculation, previous empirical research, and the like. So, the nature of the problem will give you some idea about heteroscedasticity from your theoretical knowledge. Now, we discuss two types of methods to detect heteroscedasticity. One is the formal methods. The one is the informal methods. The other one is the formal methods. In the category of informal methods, two methods are suggested. One is a priori information. A priori information. The second one is graphical methods. Methods. There are so many formal methods, we will discuss them one by one. Now, there is a point I want to say. Heteroscedasticity is written as expected ui square is equal to sigma square I. So, you can calculate sigma square 1, sigma square 2, etc. sigma square n if the entire population corresponding to each x is known. But we have only one x, one y corresponding to one x. Also, u is unknown. All our procedures are based on u hat I, on the assumption that u hat I is a good estimator of ui. U hat I is a good estimator of ui. So, actually, we estimate a model. After estimating the model, we will get the residuals. Then all our methods to detect heteroscedasticity is based on the residuals. Based on the residuals. So this should be kept in mind always. Now, a priori information simply means information available from previous empirical work. For example, in the relation between consumption and income, saving and income, etc., heteroscedasticity is generally expected because of the heterogeneous nature of units. A classic example is the family budget studies of Price and Hautaker. Family based studies of Price and Hautaker. In the family budget studies, they analyzed extensively the relation between income and consumption, saving and consumption, etc., and observed that heteroscedasticity is a problem. So if you undertake such a study, you always suspect heteroscedasticity. That is an informal method, not a formal method. Now consider, if a priori information is not available, a second method is graphical method. It is also an informal method. Now let me say, what is this graphical method? Suppose that we regress y on x, obtain u hat I, and square it. Obtain u hat I and square it. And we see whether u hat I square exhibits any systematic patterns when we plot u hat I square against y hat I. Let it be u hat I square, and this is y hat I. Suppose that u hat I square is like this. Another case is, like this. A third case, like this. We are plotting u hat I square because u hat I may be positive or negative. And heteroscedasticity is error variance. That is why we square it and plot it. Or like this. Like this. Now we plot u hat I square against y hat I. As I told you, we square u hat I because we are considering error variance, a squared quantity. U hat I can be positive or negative. And in the first case, as y hat I increases, u hat I square is remaining the same. No systematic pattern. This is the case of homoscedasticity. The case of homoscedasticity. In all these cases, there are systematic patterns. For example, in this case, there is a linear relationship between y hat and I, u hat I square. And in these two cases, there is a quadratic relation between u hat I square and y hat I. So these four cases exhibits some form of heteroscedasticity. Now, you can plot u hat I square against xi also. Suppose that we regress y on x only. And as I told you, if expected u hat I square is equal to sigma square I, it also means that it is a function of xi. That is, error variance is a function of xi. Actually, it is x which causes heteroscedasticity. So if there is only one explanatory variable, you simply plot u hat I square against xi instead of y hat I and observe whether any systematic pattern is observed. Can be any pattern, quadratic, linear, whatever pattern. It's a case of heteroscedasticity. If you regress y on x2, x3, etc., then we do not know which x is causing heteroscedasticity. In that case, we plot u hat I square against each xi. First we plot against x2, then we plot against x3, xk, and we try to see which x is causing heteroscedasticity. Remember this, in the two variable model, you can plot u hat I square against y hat I or xi, both are same. When we consider a multiple linear regression model, you plot u hat I square against each xi, then only you can see which x is causing heteroscedasticity. These are the two informal methods. And always remember this, once a model is estimated, you will get the residual. Then you must plot this residual against xi or y hat I in order to see whether there is any systematic pattern, especially if you have cross-section data. In time series data also we will plot it to discover whether there is autocorrelation, that we will discuss later. Now let us see what are the formal methods. What are the formal methods? There are a lot of methods suggested from time to time to discover heteroscedasticity, and we will discuss all these. And after discussing all these, I will specify which tests are the most commonly used. The first one is the Park test. Park test is a formalization of the graphical method which we have discussed. That is, we assume that sigma square I is some function of xi. Sigma square I is some function of xi. And Park suggested the functional form sigma square I is equal to, suggested the functional form sigma square xi raised to beta e raised to vi. This is the functional form suggested by Park. And taking log ln sigma square I is equal to ln sigma square plus beta ln xi plus vi. Beta ln xi plus vi, where vi is, as usual, the stochastic error term. Since this sigma square I is unknown, what we do is we regress y on x and we obtain u hat I and square it and use it for detecting heteroscedasticity. Ln u hat I square is equal to ln sigma square plus beta ln xi plus vi. And we propose the hypothesis H0 beta is equal to 0 versus H1 beta is not equal to 0. Now suppose that if this null hypothesis is accepted, then we will say that error variance is caused by xi. If this null hypothesis is accepted, then ln u hat I square is ln sigma square, a constant homoscedasticity. So the procedure is, we regress y on x, obtain u hat I, square it, then ln u hat I square is regressed on ln xi. And if beta is significant, then there is heteroscedasticity, otherwise there is homoscedasticity. Now let me generalize this procedure. In the generalization, this test is known as Park LM test. Park LM test. I suggest this because if you are using the software eViews for your regression analysis, in the eView software, Park test is given to detect heteroscedasticity, but how it is given is different from this. So you will be familiar with how it is used in eView software. Let the model is yi is equal to beta 1 plus beta 2 x 2 y plus beta k x k I plus u I, a general k variable model. You regress y on this, obtain u hat. Then we regress ln u hat I square. ln u hat I square, the same ln u hat I square on a1 plus a2 z2y plus a3 z3i plus etc. ap zpi plus vi. ap zpi plus vi. And as you can see, in the original model, the variables are x. In the auxiliary regression, it is z2, z3, etc., zp. In general, this zk is equal to zp. In general, that is, in the auxiliary regression also, all the explanatory variables will be, so z is same as x. Z1 is x2 is z2, sk is zp, like that, in the auxiliary regression. Now, we formulate the hypothesis, h0, a2 is equal to, a3 is equal to, etc., ap equal to 0. Against, not all these a2, a3, etc., ap simultaneously equal to 0. Now, this is the null hypothesis. To test this hypothesis, we use what is known as LM. LM is equal to n into r square. This quantity follows chi square with the p minus 1 degrees of freedom. N into r square follows chi square with the p minus 1 degrees of freedom, where n is the sample size. R square is R square from the auxiliary regression. R square from the auxiliary regression. Now, why it is known, and while discussing the maximum likelihood methods, we have introduced three test statistics. I think you still remember this. Likelihood ratio, Wald, Lagrange multiplier. The test statistics associated with all these is chi square. And as we have seen, these tests are supplementary to F. In most cases, F is enough. F is formulated in terms of R square. LM here is also formulated in terms of R square. And this is how it is presented in EVU's software. So if you have a multiple linear regression model, you simply run it, the software will give you a command, and this is the regression we are running to detect heteroscedasticity, and this is the hypothesis. The test statistics is known as LM test. I will explain this in detail at a later time when we consider the Busch-Pagen test. Actually, there are four LM tests, all are variants of this equation that I will explain. So LM n into r square, and if the chi square obtained from the sample is greater than the critical chi square, we reject H0. There is heteroscedasticity. Otherwise, accept H0. Accept H0 means this is equal to even A1, there is no heteroscedasticity. This test is known as the Park test.